life so hard? And why do you seem so far? But if this cup opens, help me to stay steadfast, let your will be done. You get the glory from this. You get the glory from this. No matter what I have to go through in this world, as long as you get the glory from me.
Shepherd, there's nothing I need. You lead me to the safest places. Lead me to the safest places. To walk in the meadow and lie by the stream. You meet me in the quiet places. You meet me in the quiet places. And your goodness and your mercy will follow me all the days of my life, all the days of my life. And I'll dwell in your house for eternity. I'll be there by your side. I'll be there by your side.
Comfort in my protection. You're the shepherd of my.
stand together and sing No Longer Slaves. Unravel me with a melody, and you surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies, till all my fears are gone. I'm no longer a slave, I'm no longer a slave to fear. I'm a child, I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. From my mother's womb, you have chosen me.
Thankful for that. I go back to the words of the Apostle Paul in Galatians 4, where he says this in verse 1, what I am saying is that as long as an heir is underage, he's no different from a slave, although he owns the whole estate. The heir is subject to guardians and trustees until the time set by his father. So also, when we were underage, we were in slavery under the elemental spiritual forces of the world. But when the set time had fully come, God sent his son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those under the law, that we might receive adoption to sonship. Because you are his sons, God sent the spirit of his son into our hearts, the spirit who calls out, Abba, Father. So you are no longer a slave, but God's child. And since you are his child, God has made you also an heir, which is incredible news. He goes on to say in verse 8, formerly, when you did not know God, you were slaves to those who by nature are not God's, But now that you know God, or rather are known by God, how is it that you are turning back to those weak and miserable forces? Do you wish to be enslaved by them all over again? You are observing special days and months and seasons and years. Verse 11, I fear for you that somehow I have wasted my efforts. As I think about that this morning, there is such an encouragement and an ownership, as we've sang that song of, I'm no longer a slave to fear. I'm no longer a slave in that, but that we get to walk in adopted sonship, in child relationship with him this morning. And I'm so thankful for that. And my heart's cry for each of us today would be that as we continue to worship, as we continue to hear the word, that we would own that, that we would live in that place that says, I am a child of God. Deep down inside, it's not a wasted effort. I've been set free by the Most High King. So with that, you can take a seat for a hot second. Good morning. Welcome to Mission Community Church. My name is Andy. I'm one of the pastors here at Mission, and it is a delight to have you here at this 10:30 a.m. service on Sunday morning. There is a lot happening here in the life of the church, and you can stay connected with all of that at our website, missioncommunity.church, where you can sign up for our e-newsletter that comes out every Wednesday. Make sure you read to the end. It is chock full of good information. You can also find us on Facebook and Instagram. Our handle is @missiondowningtown, where our team does a great job keeping you apprised of what's happening here in the life of the church. You can also find us in the Church Center app, which you can download wherever you get your apps from. If you download that, open it and search Mission Community Church. It will lead you along the way to everything happening here as well. If Mission's your home church, we are so thankful for your faithfulness in your giving and support of God's mission and vision right here in Downingtown and the surrounding areas. We are so thankful for that. You can give in a few different ways. Again, on our website, missioncommunity.church, you can text any amount to 84321 and follow the prompts to set up giving through there. By mail here at 216 East Lancaster Ave in Downingtown, or in the drop boxes located at either side door as you head out this morning. As well in those drop boxes, if this is your first Sunday or maybe your fifth and you've never connected with us further, there's a Connect card in the seat back in front of you, and they're also out on the welcome kiosk outside. If you would just fill one of those out, we don't want to stalk you or sell your information, just want to connect further as we can, and those can go in the box as well. That's also available at missioncommunity.church/connect, where we'd love to connect with you. Next Sunday, during the 8:30 and 10:30 a.m., we have baby and child dedications happening April 21st. You can register online at our website and Church Center. You can scan the QR code here on the screen behind me. Those are exciting Sundays that are not really about the child and are a whole lot about our intention as a church community and family to come alongside parents, to come alongside as the church, and commit to raising children up in the church and in Christ. And so we would encourage you, if you've not done that, to jump in and participate with that as we look forward to that. All right, would you stand with me one more time here this morning? And as we jump into Quick Connect, if you look around the room and find somebody that you've never met before, that is the person you should go say hey to.
Of grace. strong the hand that holds us. Beautiful, so beautiful.
Love endures through generations.
guard your children, then you hear your children now. You are the same God. You are the same God. You answered prayers back then, and you will answer now. You are the same God. You are the same God. You were providing then. You are providing now. You are the same God. You are the same God. You moved in power then. God, move in power now. You are the same God. You are the same God. You were a healer then. You're still a healer now. You are the same God. You are the same God. You were the Savior then. You're still my Savior now. You are the same God. You are the same God. Oh God, my God, I need you. Oh God, my God, I need you now. How I need you now. Oh rock, oh rock of ages, I'm standing on your faithfulness, on your faithfulness. Oh God, my God, I need you. Oh God, my God, I need you now. How I need you now.
That moment for a minute. Our need for Christ and his faithfulness to us. Just thank him right now. We thank you, Jesus. We thank you for providing a way. You are salvation. You are the healer of our souls.
There's two kinds of people in the world, I think, if I can break it up. Those that know they need Christ, not just for salvation, but just every day for living, that he's always with us, always sustaining us. And those that don't know it. But there's one thing that we all have in common, is that we all need Jesus. That he created us, he gives us the air we breathe, even those that don't acknowledge it. But the greatest need is to know him for eternity. And I don't normally do this, but if you're that person that doesn't know that Jesus died for you, and that without his death, there would be no eternal life, that you will not be with Jesus, but he's offering freely and lovingly for you to accept his salvation, to accept the gift that he did on the cross, dying for you. I don't know how I know it. I don't know how the Holy Spirit came and revealed it to those that know him, but only the Holy Spirit can do it. So I would say just yield yourself, whether you know him or not, just yield yourself to the Holy Spirit today and let him teach you
things that you've never seen before, that you've never known before. Oh God, we want more of you. We want to know you better, no matter where we're at with you. We want to know more of you and experience more of you. We want to experience more of your healing of the sin in our souls, Lord. Healing in the body for those that need it. Lord, in our finances, Lord. Lord, in our families and our relationships with our friends, Lord. We cannot sustain things without you, Lord. It seems that we do well for a while, Lord, but without you, it's all going to come to nothing. So, Lord, we just thank you and we bless you this morning for your goodness to us. Or not, sing it with me.
Blessed are those who run to him, who place their hope and confidence in Jesus. He won't forsake them. And blessed are those who seek his face, who bend their knee and fix their gaze on Jesus. They won't be shaken. So come on and praise the Lord with me. Sing if you love his name. Come on and lift your voice with me. He's worthy of all our praise. Blessed are those who walk with him, whose hearts are set on pilgrimage with Jesus. They'll see his glory. And blessed are those who die to live, whose joy it is to give it all for Jesus. And for him
are many things to be thankful for today. From even the seemingly insignificant, I'm thankful that today is going to be 70 and not windy. Yesterday we were out on the ball fields all day, 62 degrees, and I still had my winter coat on to try to cut down on the wind. But even just the blessing of enjoying the warmth of the sun, thankful for that. But way beyond that, that we have life in Jesus Christ. We're in a series entitled Today and Forever, in which we are talking about life after death. And this is important because I've made the argument that what we believe about life after death ought to impact how we live today. Last week, we talked about what happens when our physical bodies die, and I kind of gave you a little bit of a warning, and here you are. You showed back up. Today, we're talking about a pretty difficult subject. We're talking about hell. And as I was talking to my wife, Colleen, about this particular message, she's like, pretty worried, concerned. Hey, are you going to do like the sandwich approach? You're going to do a positive, a negative, and a positive. And I said, well, you know, kind of last Sunday was a positive. Next Sunday is a positive. And so you have to come back next week too to get the positive side when we talk about the glories of heaven. But today we talk about the difficult reality of hell. So I'm going to pray for us. I'm going to ask you, if you're a praying person, if you wouldn't mind praying for me. Because as much as you don't want to hear it, I don't necessarily want to preach it. But we can't just always talk about God's faithfulness, God's love, God's grace, God's mercy. As a preacher, I'm called to preach the whole counsel of God. And this is one of those topics. So, Heavenly Father, we thank you and praise you for your unending love and faithfulness. Even as we've sung, you are the same yesterday, today, and forever. And you've showed your love to us in sending your son Jesus to die for our sins. And that we are raised to new life in Christ. And I pray that is the case for every single person in this room, for every single person that's tuning in online. And Lord, would by the power of your Spirit, guide us in all truth. Help us to know what we need to know. And help us to be transformed from the inside out based on what you want us to know. We want to honor and glorify you in all that we do. In Jesus' name, amen. Give a couple fist pumps as you make your way to your seat to those around you. What we believe about life after death ought to impact how we live today. That's really the overarching idea of this entire series, talking about life after death. What we believe about eternity ought to determine how we live here on earth, because the reality is, at least based on the scriptures, is that everyone will exist somewhere forever. And as we talk about hell today, I think one of the important things that we need to know is that we cannot fully appreciate the glories of heaven, the glories of the gospel, the glories of God's love, if we don't also fully accept the reality of hell. That inherent in good news is bad news. That in order for there to be good news, there has to also be bad news. And so we cannot fully appreciate the glories of heaven that we'll talk about next week until we accept the reality of hell. Now, I can remember the first time that I was confronted with the reality of hell. I grew up in the Baptist church, and starting in the second grade, I attended this Baptist school until I graduated high school. And one of the rhythms of that Christian school that I attended, not only did we learn about reading, writing, arithmetic, science, and history, but we also had Bible classes. So Mondays, Wednesdays, and Fridays, we would have Bible classes. And then on Tuesdays and Thursdays, we would have this thing called chapel. And essentially what chapel is, it's just a mini church service for the school. So we would have different teachers that would preach messages. We would bring in guest preachers and all of that. And I can remember this one chapel service when I was in third grade. This guy comes in, don't know where he came from, but he was preaching hell, fire, and brimstone. I mean, beet red as he was getting into the message. Like he had this vein popping outside the side of his neck. It was intense. And as he got to the end of his message, I can remember him very specifically asking the question, are you certain that if you were to die today, you would spend an eternity with Jesus? Now, in my third grade understanding and mind, I thought to myself, well, can you really be certain? Like fully, truly certain? Like I knew all the answers, but could you really be certain? How you doing, Charles? So he asked this question and he said, are you certain? If you're not certain, I should say, if you're not certain that if you were to die today, you would spend an eternity in heaven with Jesus, raise your hand. Up goes my hand. And I'm thinking to myself, surely there's a lot of others that are raising their hands with me. So after I raise my hand, this preacher then says, okay, if you raise your hands, I want you to just look up at me. Everybody's heads were bowed and eyes were closed. I looked up and he's staring dead into my soul. And I quickly look around. I don't see anybody else raising their hand. I don't see anybody else looking up. And I mean, there's like probably 100 more of us. Like there's a lot of people. And I'm like, uh-oh, I'm not in Kansas anymore. And what he did next, I will never forget. I mean, I felt like I was sitting in a movie theater with like Dolby digital surround sound. It echoes in my mind even to this day. He said this to me as he's searing into my soul. If you do not place your faith and trust in Jesus, you will go to hell.
Hell, hell, hell.
That's what I heard. It was reverberating in my mind. Scared the hell out of me. And I thought to myself, I'm getting the hell out of here. Hello, my name is Jason, and I'm a recovering Baptist. That was part of my upbringing. And from that point forward, for several years, I can remember praying over and over and over and over and over, God, please don't send me to hell. Please don't send me to hell. I don't want to go to hell. Please don't send me to hell. I want to go to heaven because I don't want to go to hell. Based on a May 2023 Gallup poll, 73% of Americans believe in heaven. . 59% of Americans believe in hell. . 4 in 10 Americans believe people go to hell who do not believe in Jesus Christ. 6 out of 10 Americans reject the existence of Satan. They kind of use him as a symbol for evil in the world, not a real actual spiritual being, but just a symbol of evil, a symbol of sin. What I found really interesting is that only 0.5%, so 0.5% of people actually think they're going to hell. Hardly anyone thinks they're going to hell. You know, that's for the murderers, the rapists, the human traffickers, the child kidnappers, I mean, the worst of the worst people. Those are the people going to hell. Surely not me. I'm a pretty decent person. I'm a good person. Very few people actually think they are going to hell. Jesus has something significant to say about this. He says in his Sermon on the Mount, Matthew chapter 7, verse 13, enter by the narrow gate. For the gate is wide, and the way is easy that leads to destruction, and those who enter by it are many. For the gate is narrow, and the way is hard that leads to life, and those who find it are few. What if Satan's strategy was to deceive people into believing that there really isn't a hell? It's just some story. It's not an actual place. It's just a metaphor. Or if he would deceive us into believing that heaven's going to be kind of boring. I mean, you really just want to sing songs all day, kind of dressed like a baby with wings, playing a harp. Like, does that sound fun to you? Or you want to go to hell where everybody's going to be. It's just going to be a great party. And even pop culture kind of, you know, feeds into this idea, you know, the great theologian Billy Joel. You know, I'd rather laugh with the sinners than die with the saint, for sinners are much more fun. So if Satan can deceive us into believing that there isn't really a hell, well, then the implications of that, if you're not a follower of Jesus, then you can just really live however you want. There are no consequences. It justifies your own sin. You can reject Christ. There's no fear of God. You don't really have anything to worry about. And if you're a Christian, a follower of Jesus who doesn't believe in hell, well, then you would live an extremely self-centered life, constantly pursuing your own comforts and conveniences, reject sacrifice and suffering, don't worry about persecution. You love the things of this world. You don't share your faith, and there's no urgency. What we believe about life after death ought to impact how we live today. So what I want to do this morning is answer two basic questions. Why does hell exist, and what is actually hell? So let's tackle that first one. Why does hell exist? I would suggest for two reasons. Number one, hell exists for God to deal righteously with Satan. Hell exists for God to deal righteously with Satan. Now, as we think about Satan, we can thank Dante for this and, again, some of our pop culture. We put Satan into this cute little character who wears a tight red suit with horns and a pitchfork and a pointy tail sitting on our shoulder, just kind of whispering things into our ears that we probably shouldn't do. We've minimized who he actually is. And what I want to make sure that we are well aware of is that Satan is the embodiment of all evil. There is no amount of good in Satan. He is all evil. Even our worst thoughts about Satan doesn't even come close to how evil he really is. When you think about every addiction, Satan is behind it. When you think about any and all abuse, Satan is behind it. He is behind all affairs. He is behind all fear. He is behind all pain and all shame. He is the embodiment of all evil. And the scriptures use very specific words to describe just how evil he is. He is called the deceiver, the destroyer, the devil, the dragon, the evil one, ruler of demons, angel of the abyss, adversary, murderer, father of lies, tempter, prince of darkness, our enemy. And his sole purpose is to steal, kill, and destroy. John chapter 10, verse 10. To steal your joy, kill your faith, ruin your life, obliterate your marriage, kidnap your kids, wreak havoc on every aspect of your life. That is his primary purpose. The church historian Richard Lovelace, he says it this way: the destructive malice of Satan against all humanity, and particularly against the church, is channeled through human agents in the systems and institutions they have built. Humanity in general is afflicted by the destroyer through the struggles of injustice and oppression of which the flesh and the devil are joint architects. And Christians are murderously attacked by individuals and governments ultimately directed by Satan. He is the embodiment of all evil. And we can even see that not only just here in our surrounding culture, but even just as of yesterday with Iran attacking Israel. He is behind every government that is evil. He is the embodiment. I cannot stress this enough. He is the embodiment of all evil. There is no good in him. His primary purpose is to steal, kill, and destroy. And Jesus says this in Matthew chapter 25, verse 41. He will say to those on his left, "Depart from me, you cursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels." So why does hell exist? Right here, hell exists for God to deal righteously with Satan. That hell was prepared, created for the devil and his angels. Number two, I would also suggest that hell exists for God to deal righteously with sinners. Now, I would imagine most of us are comfortable and can get behind the statement I just made, hell exists for God to deal righteously with Satan. I think we can all get behind that. But when we start talking about hell existing for God to deal righteously with sinners, that gets very uncomfortable very quickly. Just as you are uncomfortable hearing it, I am uncomfortable preaching it. Because we want everybody to experience God's love. We want everybody to go to heaven. To say that hell exists for God to deal righteously with sinners to the outside world, to the surrounding culture, seems very, very exclusive in a culture that's constantly preaching inclusivity. How could a so-called loving God send people to hell? I mean, my neighbor is a really good person. They don't necessarily go to church, but I mean, he's come over, he's mowed the grass for me. She makes killer brownies when I don't even ask. Like, they're really good people. How could God send them to hell? And we agree that, okay, the murderers, the rapists, the child abusers, human traffickers, terrorists, drug lords, those people should be sent into hell, but not the good people who just don't believe the same things that we believe about Jesus. Now, it's an interesting idea that I want to submit to you today, that as indignant as some people are that God would deal righteously with Satan and sinners, how they are against that, those same people are often indignant by the injustices that happen here on earth. We live in this culture that someone's gotta pay for it. So you hurt me, I'm gonna hurt you. You speak badly about me, I'm gonna speak badly about you. An eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth. You scream for reparations, retaliations, revenge, wars. So in one side of our breath, we're saying that God can't deal righteously with sin, while here on earth, sin better be handled. Your wrongdoing better be handled. You gotta pay for it. And what we've done is we attempt to make God in our own image so that we ultimately can just live comfortable in our own sin. That we don't have to stand before God with the wrongs that we've done. God is perfectly just and perfectly holy and perfectly righteous. And because he is perfectly just, holy, and righteous, he must deal with sin, including sinners who reject the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so Paul says in 2 Thessalonians chapter 1 that he, speaking of Jesus, will come with his mighty angels in flaming fire, bringing judgment on those who don't know God and on those who refuse to obey the good news of our Lord Jesus. They will be punished with eternal destruction, forever separated from the Lord and from his glorious power. At the end of the day, every single one of us has the right to choose. We can either receive the good news of the gospel or we can reject it. two choices. Jesus says, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Now, culture doesn't like that. How can there only be one way? How is Jesus the only way? That's very exclusive. We are so twisted around the axle with there only being one way when we should be over here celebrating. At least there is a way. There is a way out of our sin. There is a way out of our destruction as we come to Jesus. There is life and life everlasting. I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except by me. And so the bad news is, if you reject Jesus, if you reject his glorious gospel, then hell exists for God to deal righteously with you. We cannot fully appreciate the glories of heaven if we do not fully accept the reality of hell. Why does hell exist? Hell exists for God to deal righteously with Satan and sinners. Okay, well, what exactly is hell? There are a lot of smarter people than me that have come to a lot of different conclusions on exactly what hell is, ranging from a theological term, eternal conscious torment, on one side of the spectrum, over to the other side of the spectrum of annihilationism. So essentially, annihilationism is if you go to hell, your soul will just be completely annihilated. You'll cease to exist as if you won't even remember you had any existence whatsoever. Where conscious eternal torment subscribes to an actual place, an actual hell where there is torment, and you're aware of this torment that happens forever and ever. I'm going to share with you my belief on what hell is. And this is coming from my understanding and my interpretation of the scriptures. What I would encourage all of us to do, no matter whether it's my belief or not, like get into the Bible and study this out for yourself. It's the responsibility that we have as followers of Jesus. So let me introduce you to some terms in which we use the English word hell. So in the Old Testament, there is a Hebrew word sheol. Everybody say sheol. And then in the New Testament, there's a Greek word Hades. Everybody say Hades. These two words are basically equivalent. It's meaning the same thing in the Old Testament Hebrew language and the New Testament Greek language. Sometimes those words, as you're reading through the scriptures, can be translated in our English, the grave, the pit, hell that we just said, the place of the dead. And essentially what they are using to describe this place, Sheol and Hades, it's an intermediate state of disembodied souls. So let's go back to last week's sermon. What are the three things that happen to every single person when they die? Their physical bodies die. Their spiritual souls detach from their physical bodies. And at some point, they will face judgment. If you are a Christian, a follower of Jesus, you will face the judgment seat of Christ, in which you will be given rewards for how you lived here on this earth. If you're an unbeliever and rejected Jesus, then you'll be facing the great white throne judgment that's recorded for us in the book of Revelation. So three things that happen to every single person. Our physical bodies die, our souls detach from our physical bodies, and then we'll face judgment. In the Old Testament and the New Testament, there is this belief that when your soul detached from your body that had died, you would end up in this intermediate state called either Sheol or Hades. And one of the primary passages in which we get this understanding is in Luke chapter 16. Luke chapter 16, there's a story of a rich man who was clothed in purple linen. So for us, we need to think like Bill Gates, Jeff Bezos, Elon Musk, I mean, filthy rich. He had this mansion with a gate at the end of his driveway. And then you had this poor man named Lazarus. Not the same Lazarus that was raised from the dead by Jesus. This is a different Lazarus. And as you're reading through Luke chapter 16, you would have this poor man Lazarus sitting at the edge of the gate just begging for the crumbs from the rich man's table. We pick it up in verse 22. The poor man, speaking of Lazarus, died and was carried by the angels to Abraham's side. Some translations use the word bosom. The rich man also died and was buried. And in Hades, everybody say Hades. And in Hades, being in torment, he, speaking of the rich man, lifted up his eyes and saw Abraham far off and Lazarus by his side. And he called out, "Father Abraham, have mercy on me and send Lazarus to dip the end of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am in anguish in this flame." Now, there's a weird thing kind of happening here. Some people believe that this is a parable that Jesus is saying. I don't think this is an actual parable of Jesus. I think this is something that Jesus is using, an actual happening, to explain what is going on life after death. So you have a rich man and Lazarus. They both die. Their physical bodies died. Their souls detached. Both are in this intermediate place called Hades. And as you read a little bit further in Luke chapter 16, it says there is this great chasm that exists where the rich man was and where Lazarus and Abraham was. One side of this chasm was full of pain. The other side, full of peace. One side is all torment. The other side, it's paradise. So in this intermediate state, there exists this place where these disembodied souls reside. Hades has often been used more from a negative context, that it's the bad side of that intermediate state. And so this is why sometimes we translate the word Hades into hell, and it kind of blurs our understanding of what this actually is. Now, let's use the other word, hell. And there's another Greek word in which we translate into our English word hell, and that is the Greek word Gehenna. Everybody say Gehenna. Gehenna is often referred to as the eternal state of hell. So if you have Hades is this intermediate state of hell, Gehenna is the eternal state of hell. Have I lost anybody yet? Dig into your Bibles later on. Gehenna comes from it's actually two words that describe a physical place. Outside of the city of Jerusalem, there is this valley referred to as the Valley of Hinnom. This is where we get that Greek word Gehenna, the Valley of Hinnom. We have to go all the way back to the Old Testament in 2 Kings. And when you're reading through 2 Kings, the people of Israel are completely disregarding God. They've rejected him. They've worshipped all kinds of other gods. And in 2 Kings chapters 16 and 21, there's two wicked kings, King Ahaz and King Manasseh. And under their leadership, the people of Israel, God's chosen people, they are actually taking their own children and they are sacrificing their children to the god Moloch. And it's happening right here at the Valley of Hinnom, Gehenna. As you get into the Old Testament where these prophets show up onto the scene, specifically Jeremiah, they start preaching against this practice. And they are warning the people of Israel, this place is going to become a place and a symbol of God's divine wrath and judgment for how egregious this sin actually was. And then when you get to the New Testament, there is this literal place, this Valley of Hinnom, that sits outside the walls of Jerusalem, and it was a place in which the city threw all of its trash, all of its dead animals, whatever they didn't want. It would be in this constant state of burning. It was a dump site. And it was used as a place that Jesus would reference on frequent occasion, this is symbolic of the eternal damnation that is reserved for Satan and for sinners. So when we see that word Gehenna used in the Greek, it's referred to as eternal punishment, Matthew chapter 25. Everlasting destruction, 2 Thessalonians chapter 1. Unquenchable fire, Matthew chapter 3. Damnation, Matthew chapter 23. Blackest darkness in Jude chapter 13. And a fiery lake of burning sulfur, Revelation chapter 21. So it is a place that is characterized by isolation, outer darkness, the blackest darkness, yet at the same time, there's eternal fire. There's no relief. There's no God, no other people that you're in association with, no hope whatsoever. So if Hades is referred to as this intermediate place of punishment of disembodied souls, then hell is the eternal place of punishment for eternal bodies. Because everyone experiences a resurrection, and then you are sent to one of two places. Starting in Revelation chapter 20. Revelation chapter 20, I referenced last week. Specifically with that great white throne judgment. And in the beginning of Revelation chapter 20, we are introduced to this concept of Christ's thousand-year reign. And there's coming a point in the future where Christ reigns for 1,000 years, and during that thousand-year reign, Satan is thrown into this pit, and that lid of that pit is sealed. He cannot escape. But then at the end of that thousand-year reign, Satan is released. And as he's released, he is amassing this humongous army to battle against God and God's people. Revelation describes it as outnumbering the sand of the sea. And so there's just a mass of people. They come to war against God and God's people. And then Revelation says that God rains down fire from heaven to defeat this army. And then we pick it up in verse 12. And the dead were judged by what was written in the books according to what they had done. So remember, the Lamb's Book of Life. If your name is not in the Lamb's Book of Life, you're cast into this eternal fire. Verse 13. And the sea gave up the dead who were in it. Death and Hades gave up the dead who were in them. And they were judged, each one of them, according to what they had done. Then death and Hades were thrown into the lake of fire. This is the second death, the lake of fire. And if anyone's name was not found written in the book of life, he was thrown into the lake of fire. What is hell? We don't know exactly what that is, but based on the description of Scripture, isolation, the blackest darkness, eternal fire, everlasting torment, I have no desire to experience that. Here's the bad news. You and I are not inherently good. We have all sinned, and we have all fallen short of God's glory, of God's righteousness, of God's holiness, of God's justice. And because God is perfectly holy, perfectly just, perfectly righteous, he must deal with Satan and with sin. But here's the good news. Just as Satan is the embodiment of all evil, God is the embodiment of all good. That he's not only righteous, not only holy, and not only just, but he is perfectly gracious, perfectly merciful, and perfectly love. That God is love. It's not just what he does. It is the very nature of who he is. God is love. He is the perfect embodiment of love. And so God prepared hell for Satan. God also prepares a way for sinners to find life in Christ. That there is a way, there is a truth, and there is life that is found in Jesus. And this is good news, that Jesus came to seek the sinner. Jesus left the 99 to go after the one. That his purpose wasn't to come deal with the righteous, but to call sinners to repentance, to call you and me to repentance. This is what he says in Luke chapter 5. Jesus answered them, "Those who have well have no need of a physician, but those who are sick. I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance." What we believe about life after death ought to impact how we live each and every moment. That we cannot fully appreciate the glories of heaven until we fully accept the reality of hell. Now, I don't want to end us on a bad note. I want to end us on a positive note. I'm taking the words of my wife. You can tell her later because she's not here right now, so she believes me. Let me read some scriptures over you tonight. Today, not tonight yet. Let me read some scriptures over you that talk about God's perfect justice, righteousness, holiness, love, grace, and mercy. John chapter 3, verse 16 and 17. "For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him." Romans chapter 5, verse 8. "But God shows his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since therefore we have now been justified by his blood, much more shall we be saved by him from the wrath of God." Romans chapter 6, verse 22. "But now that you have been set free from sin and have become slaves of God, the fruit you get leads to sanctification and its end, eternal life. For the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord." And 2 Peter 3, verse 9, "The Lord is not slow to fulfill his promise, as some count slowness, but is patient toward you, not wishing that any should perish, but all should come to repentance." Jesus came to seek and to save the lost. He died on a criminal's cross, paying the price for our sins, bringing on the full wrath of God upon him, satisfying his justice, displaying his amazing grace and mercy to those who would place their faith and trust in him. And with the love that he first loved us, we love him in complete surrender and devotion, that the goal now for us is to not scare people out of hell, but to love them into heaven, because he is a good God. Let's stand together as we sing.
God in the sanctuary, bless God in the fields of plenty, bless God in the darkest valley, every chance I get, I bless your name. Bless God when my hands are empty, bless God with a praise that costs me, bless God when nobody's watching, every chance I get, I bless your name. Bless God when the weapon's forming, bless God when the walls are falling, bless God 'cause he goes before me, every chance I get, I bless your name. Bless God, for he holds the victory. Bless God, for he's always with me. Bless God, 'cause he's always worthy.
Pastor Jason, that is a tough message to preach. That was a lot to listen to even the second time around, and I can't imagine having to stand up here and share a lot of that. I appreciated someone, we were talking with someone out in the lobby after the first service between the two here that said, holy smokes, that is a lot to digest and think about, but I'm so thankful for it to be able to think about it. I hope that you would be encouraged in the same way that, okay, here's the information. What can I do with this? Some things that we don't talk about in the church a lot, and you might feel even a little cringy or weird about, not because you disagree, but because it's like, holy smokes, this is something to think about. So I hope as you do that, that you can be encouraged. I love where we landed of, it's not about trying to scare people out of hell. It's about understanding this is where we're at. This is who God made us and desires us to be. How can we love people into heaven with that? And our heart's cry would be that you would do that from here this week. So thanks again for being with us. If you would like prayer for anything at all today, our prayer team will be around the front here for a few minutes here afterwards. Please come up with them. Other than that, have a great rest of your Sunday, and we'll see you next week.
That's way you want me.